Yeah, Lord yeah. God, you have blessed us with gifts. You put stuff in us before we were even born, Lord God. Father God, we thank you, Lord God, for how you blessed us to be clothed yes. and in our right mind in this house, Lord God, on today. Lord God, you have a word for your people, Lord yes. God. You have a commission for your people, Lord God. You have a relaunching, Lord God. You have a reset, Father God.
All right.
You have, Lord God, a momentum to do this thing, this next thing, Lord God, quickly, Father God. So, Lord, we thank you for what you are doing. We thank you, Father God, that how you're going to do it, Lord God. We thank you, Father God, because we came here, Lord God, seeking your face, seeking the how, seeking the why, seeking the where. So, Lord God, give us the answers. Give us our purpose, Lord God. Show us where we fit in this puzzle in the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you for being God. Hallelujah. Yes. We thank you that you are God that answers
yes.
the unanswered yes. questions, Lord God. We thank you that you are the God that opens up the secrets that no man can provide the answer. So, Lord God, touch our minds today. Touch our hearts today. Touch our souls today. Give us everything we need, Lord God. Let us, Lord God, step out, Lord God. Help us, Lord God, move forward in the name of Jesus. Help us, Lord God, get in position, Lord God, for the next in the name of Jesus. Lord God, hide me behind the cross in the name of Jesus. Lord God, let no flesh have any glory in the name of Jesus, but let your will be done in the name of Jesus. Let your kingdom come right here, right now. Lord God, let your glory drop in this house in the name of Jesus. And Father, we thank you. Father, we bless you. Father, we praise you. Father, we honor you. Father, we thank you in advance for what you are about to do. So, Lord God, have your way. In Jesus' name we pray and ask it all. Amen?
Amen.
And amen. Hallelujah. So what happened was, I was like, Lord, what are you doing? Y'all may be seated. Lord, what are you doing? And I need you to get your Bibles close to you because we're gonna get the word. Amen?
Amen.
But how I got here was, I'm like, Lord, what are you doing? 2 years ago, I left Baylor, working there for 15 years. And all of a sudden, I get a call, somebody saying they got a job for me.
Uh-huh.
Now, I didn't apply for this job. Okay? Did not apply for it, but I'm like, okay.
Mm-hmm.
Let me see what you're talking about.
Yeah.
And at that point in time, that was the most money I ever made in my life. So I was like, where you want me to go?
Yeah.
I've been doing this all this time. Let me go.
Yeah.
Willing to go in a new challenge place.
Yeah.
So in this season, I need you to hear God. And I need you to be willing to go in the next challenge place. Okay? So I get there, and this new place is in Carrollton. And I'm like, okay, Lord, I've been here before in the city of Carrollton. Matter of fact, this is where I accepted my calling. God has a sense of humor.
Mm-hmm.
So I accepted my calling in the city of Carrollton. And guess who else accepted their calling in the city of Carrollton?
Okay, all right.
And so I'm like, okay, this full circle. So when I entered into the city of Carrollton, I was like, Lord, what do you have me to do here? I know I got a job, but there's something else in Carrollton that you would have me to do. So a year passed, and I don't have an answer to that question. And sometimes in between when God puts us in a place or God moves us to a new place, we're trying to figure out, why am I here?
Yeah, right.
Why
right.
am I here? And so I'm like, all right, Lord. What else? So it was time for us, I was feeling, it's time for us to move again.
Mm.
And so I suggested to my better half, baby, don't you want to move like over here in this area? I ain't moving Why we need to move on to that? Janiyah was like, I ain't gonna worry. No, I'm from Plano. I live in Plano. So Janiyah and the other half was like, we ain't moving. So I said, okay, Lord. Another year passed. We moving to Carrollton on the 20th. So I said all of that to say, you can fight where God is going to place you. You can fight where God is going to move you. But let's make it all easy. Let's just go on and do it the first time. Let's make this progress just a little bit easier. So that we can get where we need to go. So I'm going to read a familiar scripture to you. And you can follow me in the Bible. You don't have to stand up. It's coming from Matthew chapter 28, verse 16 through 20.
Disciples.
Who's a disciple?
We all are. Amen. We better be.
Okay. Now, if y'all didn't get my teaching 2 weeks ago on Wednesday night, you can go back on Facebook or on Periscope. I talked about counting up the cost. And it was everything that was talked about counting up the cost was for disciples. Who's a disciple? So that means we all have to count up our cost. Yes. Amen? So here it says, then the 11 disciples went away into Galilee to the mountain which Jesus had appointed for them. Somebody say appointed.
Appointed.
So now I'm a disciple that's what?
Appointed.
And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Anybody in a place of doubt? You in a place of doubt. I know I'm in the house. Amen. So y'all are here just so that God can supply your word for your doubt.
All right.
Okay. So here we are, and it says, some of them doubted, and Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore. Whoa, she got loud. They stood up. He like, what's going on? Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations. Now I know we are all of the same color in here. Now there's some people on Facebook that might be a different color, but it said all nations. And so if you missed minister's class at 10 a.m., we were discussing our pastor because our pastor's feet are white. And so what I was saying that Come here. I need you to.
Oh,
okay.
Lord.
So, our pastor's feet are white. Lift up your pants leg. Okay. And so, Sister Diana was like, are those socks she was asking? Why you got them white socks on with what you got on? And I was like, girl, he's all nation. All color. He's got white. He's Jamaican. He's got freckles, Irish. It's all nations. He's representing all nations.
Good representation. All right.
So here,
that wasn't in the script this morning.
So we are here to make. We're here to make disciples of who? All nations. Doesn't matter where they come from, but it's for everybody.
Yeah.
And it says that we're to do what? Baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Amen. You may receive it. So that's a great commission, right? That's what they call it in the Bible, a great commission. So guess what you need to be on a great commission? What do you need? The Holy Ghost.
The Holy Ghost.
What do you need? You need to have Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior.
Yes.
And first and foremost, before you can even get the Holy Ghost. Amen? So you got to have Jesus. You got to have the Holy Ghost, because the Holy Ghost is going to help you discern as you go along the way. Now, I need you to put your thinking caps on, but I need you to be ready, because God has something new. we know what the commission is, and we have all authority, and we have all power to go.
Yes.
And we have all power to go to anybody. Anybody.
Yes.
Male, female, kids, anybody.
Amen.
All right? So that is your commission. Now, you have been commissioned. And it's like, but okay, that's for pastor because his title is pastor.
Mm.
That's not for me. That's for pastor.
Mm-hmm.
But remember, that said disciples. So sheep begets sheep.
Uh-huh.
She can't make goats.
Uh-huh.
She can't make horses.
Come on now.
She can't make cows. Amen? So sheep beget sheep. Disciples beget disciples.
Yes.
Disciples cannot beget goats.
Come
they
on.
Can't beget apples.
Come on.
They can't beget frogs. They
where?
Can't beget...
Where?
Amen?
Come on, come on.
So disciples beget disciples. This church... What is the name of this church?
Power
of the Gospel Ministry.
Mm-hmm.
What is the mission of this church? What's the mission?
The cheat sheet right here.
The cheat sheet right there. What is the mission of the church? Knowing, growing, showing, and then going into a sinful world to make an impact for the kingdom of God. That is our mission. What is our vision? That's our scripture, but it also is making disciples that are not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. That is our vision. Making disciples that are not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. The reason why I'm giving you a review of the place that you have been in, maybe a couple of times for y'all. Some of y'all been here for years.
Mm-hmm.
So I need to remind you
what
this church was founded on.
Come on, man.
Because we're about to go somewhere.
All right.
And we got to be ready. And we need people that are willing to work.
Come on.
Because God did not put you here to sit in.
Amen.
God did not put you here to do nothing. Nowhere in the Bible does there say a do-nothing ministry.
Come on.
Well, I just gave you your commission.
Yeah.
You're supposed to go.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And you're supposed to go to everybody. And then you're supposed to make disciples that are what? Not ashamed.
Mm-hmm.
So we have some goals over here. Our goal is to equip and edify the saints. Edifying non-believers. That's how you make a disciple, is by bringing in people that don't believe in what? Our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Right.
So that is our goal. Then how do we do this? How do we carry this out? Prayer, praise, worship, and the word. Now, I went through all of that to say, one evening, about July 2000, your pastor, Pastor Raymond Henry, Brother Red, Minister Red, Reverend Red, was not a pastor yet, but he came home from working at UPS, and something happened. I'm trying to cook, I'm coming home, I'm like, okay, going about my normal thing, and we were going to another church at that time, and he said, baby, God gave me...
He was in the shower.
Oh, I was in the shower.
Yeah.
Well, I could... I don't want that visual. So anyway, he said, what did God tell you? What did God tell you?
Oh, you asked me?
Yes.
Oh.
Since you jumped in and had to put me on the show.
He gave me the name of the church. He gave me the mission. And all the four things on the banner right here, I just rattled them off right in front of her, right?
Amen.
She said, well, write it down and all that.
Right. I said, write it down. And he was like, I don't need to write it
down
because it's all right here.
Amen.
Now, this, when he went to work that morning, he didn't have this.
Mm-hmm.
But when he came home that night,
he
had all of this, every scripture, like knowing, he recited it to me.
Yeah.
It was embedded in his brain.
Yeah.
It was in his spirit.
Amen.
It was in
Amen.
His heart.
Yeah.
Now, let me say this. There are people that go to seminary school that are hired by the church, and they lead people. There are people that are called into apostolic calling.
All right.
An apostle.
Yeah.
And I know our pastor has a problem with this. Mm-hmm. An apostle is someone who is commissioned by God.
Yeah. Yeah.
By God.
Commissioned by God.
Yeah. Come on.
So you can have all the problem you want with it, but you've been commissioned by God to start this ministry.
Come on now. Amen. Come on now. Amen.
People can tell you that there are no longer apostles, but that is a lie.
That's right.
That's true.
There are living apostles.
Come on.
Our pastor is one of the true apostles.
Yes.
Because nobody founded this ministry but God.
Yeah. Amen.
Nobody started this ministry but God. Nobody gave us money as a startup to this ministry. Nobody, no other ministry, denomination, no one else can say, Power of the Gospel Ministry is here because I gave them $50,000, because I sent them members over there, I gave them musicians, I gave them teachers. Nobody can say that about Power of the Gospel
Ministry. Amen, amen, amen.
Who is our creator?
Yes.
God.
Yes.
Who commissioned us?
God.
God.
Yes, yes.
So you have to be willing to accept the title. Because when you accept your title, apostle, when you accept your title, overseer, when you accept your title, bishop, then you can walk in. And then when you walk in your calling, then the people beneath you that are supposed to be following behind you and coming up under you can walk in their
pressure.
Ain't no pressure but the glory.
All right.
So it says in 1 Timothy, chapter 3. 1 Timothy chapter 3. I'm going to read from starting verse 1. And it says, this is a faithful saying. If a man desires the position of a bishop, he desires a good work. So how about you know your pastor is not desiring this? But guess what? You've been called. The name of today's sermon is, you've been called. You are here today because you've been called. You've been hearing the call. You've been trying to fight the call. You've been trying to kick the call back. You've been trying to push it down. You've been trying to figure out why I've been going through all this suffering, why things are happening like this, why did they treat me like that? It's because you've been called. And God is saying today, hello, answer the call.
Yeah.
So it says, first to the bishop, a bishop must be a blameless man, the husband of one wife.
Mm-hmm.
And that does not mean that you can't be divorced. It means that you need to have one wife.
Right, one wife.
Amen. Because the devil will lie to you and tell you, because you've been divorced before, you can't operate in ministry.
Mm-hmm.
And that is a lie.
Mm-hmm.
It says temperate. Mm-hmm. Now, I know when I'm going crazy and losing my mind, your pastor is like, he's trying to tell Joe. He's all calm and I'm going. What about temperate, sober-minded, of good behavior? Pastor never been to jail. Pastor hadn't had a ticket in 20 years. Hadn't had a wreck in 20 years. Okay. Of good behavior. Hospitable and able to teach. Not given to wine. Pastor never, even back in the day when he was trying to hang out, he never drank. Not given to wine. Not violent and not greedy. Trust me, our bank account is because your pastor is generous. He giving to everybody. He bringing home strays. Now he got his son bringing home strays. He's been bringing people home. He's not greedy for money, but he's gentle. Even when I try to argue, he's trying to make me laugh. He's not quarrelsome. He's not covetous. He's not looking. He wants an Escalade, but he's not doing anything in the world to get one. Amen? He's standing strong and praying. Amen? So he's not covetous. For one who rules his own house well, having his children in submission with all reverence. Well, we got a little work on today. In verse 5 it says, for if a man does not know how to rule his own house, how can he take care of the church of God? Now, you know the enemy will throw that brick at you. Now, I'm reading this. None of us have perfect houses.
No, come on now.
None of us have perfect health.
No.
But what we do do is we pray.
Yes.
We do correct with the word.
Yeah.
And then we pray some more.
Yeah. Yeah.
And let God have it. Our job as parents is to train up our children in the way that they should go. So that when they're old enough, when they're old, they will not stray.
Yeah.
They won't go far from it. They might put their foot in the cold water.
Mm-hmm.
They might, you know, dibble and dab, but they will not stray far from God. Amen?
Amen?
So we keep on. It says, verse 6, not a novice. A novice is somebody doing this like a hobby. See, God will work it in such a way that trials and tests will come to you over and over again to see if you're going to quit this walk. To see if you're going to go back into the world. To see if you're going to do the things that you used to do. A novice would be like, deuces, I'm gone.
Right.
But someone that's not a novice is going to stand through having 100 members or having 2 members.
Right.
A novice is going to be one that's going to go through long suffering. That no matter what, no matter the one that you thought you could lean on are gone. Your Aaron and your Hur, like Moses. If your Aaron and your Hur are down there making gold calves, you still don't quit.
Come on now.
See, a novice is somebody that would quit. They'd be like, oh, they made a gold calf. Well, let me go worship with them. See, that's a novice. But our pastor, our apostle is not a novice. Our bishop is not a novice. Least being puffed up with pride, he fell into the same condemnation as the devil. See, the devil worshipped, was a beautiful worshiper. His body was a worship instrument. And he had so much pride that he wanted to be God. But it says, don't fall like the devil. Be humble. Stay humble. Verse 7 says, moreover, he must have a good testimony among those who are outside, lest he fall into reproach and the snare of the devil. Amen? Y'all, circle the 8 through 13. That's your part. See, when the bishop, the overseer, or apostle gets in position, then our part, as our part, every part doing their share, our part is this. It says, and it's talking about deacons, but it's for the whole house of God. Amen?
Amen.
So it says, likewise, deacons must be reverent, not double-tongued, not given to much wine, not greedy for money, holding the ministry of the faith with a pure conscience.
Yeah, yeah.
But let these also first be tested, then let them serve as deacons, being found blameless. Likewise, their wives must be reverent, not slanderers, temperate, faithful in all things.
Mm.
So, when I read the Great Commission to you, when I read the Great Commission to you, that is for who? All disciples.
Yeah.
But then God is saying, once you've been discipled, then now I need you to branch off into your purpose place.
Amen.
And so I need you to understand that where you start out when you first get saved is not where you're going to end up. So you are not destined to be an usher your whole life,
right,
or a door greeter your whole life.
Right.
You, God is developing you. He's equipping your mind. He's edifying you so that you can get in there, but then move on. You need to put a replacement in the spot.
That's good. That's good.
That you go
all right
when you take your
that's
next
good
step.
Yeah.
So God has me over children's
that's
ministry
good
now. So now I'm over children's ministry, but I'm raising up some other children's ministry leaders behind me so that when I move into another level of ministry, there's somebody there to take over.
Right.
Mm. But if we're a church that doesn't want to accept our call, if we're a church that doesn't want to accept our next, then we end up with open gaps and spaces. Because every part wasn't sufficient. That every part, this part left, that part left, this one said, I ain't doing that, I don't like this. So let's go to Timothy, 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy chapter 1. 2 Timothy chapter 1. I'm going to read starting at verse 3. And it says, I thank God whom I serve with a pure conscience. Anybody serving God with a pure conscience? As my forefathers did, as without ceasing, I remember you in my prayers night and day, greatly desiring to see you, being mindful of your tears, that I may be filled with joy. When I call to remembrance the genuineness of your faith that is in you, which dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and in your mother Eunice, and I am also persuaded in you also.
Yes.
Anybody come from a family of saved people?
Right, right.
Like, was your grandmother saved?
Yes.
Your mother saved? Okay, so y'all good. We didn't.
Come on.
We came from straight up heathen. We did. We went to church, Easter, Mother's Day. Yeah. Yeah. Christmas. Pastor was with the Catholic school. And his mother and father abandoned him. So, you know what the great thing about us is? We don't have denomination.
Right. Traditional stuff.
Traditional holds.
Right.
So guess what? We're free.
Yep.
Yeah.
And guess what? We listen to the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
So when people are saying, well, we got to have, you know, you got to do a slow song and a fast song. And then then it's time for you to do the announcement. And then you got to have the welcome. And then you, when you follow those doctrinal lines, and we should be out. And we're going to be out in a few minutes. But we should.
Yeah.
It's taking too long. That's not freedom.
Right.
That's not liberty. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is
liberty.
So where the Spirit of the Lord lives, then you are free to do what he has commissioned you
to do.
There
you go. There you go.
So here it says in 2 Timothy chapter 2, it says in verse 5, I thank God. No, I'm sorry, verse 6. Therefore, I remind you to stir up the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but power, love, and a sound mind. So God put a gift in you, and he commissioned the leaders, the apostle, the pastor, the teacher. See, God showed me in the beginning that pastor was the one that was a fisher. He was a fisherman, but I'm a cleaner. Pastor's a fisher, but I'm a cleaner. And if you think back on the years of ministry and really look at what I've been operating in, I'm the one that makes everybody mad. Because I'm a cleaner. See, a fish cleaner is going to be one that's going to scrape the scale. It's going to be the one that's going to cut you. It's going to open up and take the stuff out. See, when you're a cleaner, I might hurt you, but it's because I love you and God loves you, and it's so that we can be in the right place.
Come on, yes.
So the face of the ministry, the apostle, he's the one that brings in the fish. But then there's people, the pastor, teachers, that clean the fish.
That
equip the fish so that they can go out and do more fishing. You teach a man to fish.
He'll
never go hungry.
Never go hungry, that's right.
You teach a man to fish, he'll never go hungry. You teach a man to fish,
He's got limitless,
unlimited
resources.
Yes.
You teach them to fish.
Yes.
But if you teach your kids to depend on you, there'll be a 40-year-old man sitting on
your house. In your house.
You teach your kids to depend on you, where you wash their clothes and you do everything for them, and you pay their bills, and you pick everything up, and you get them out of trouble and out of jail. They're going to be 30, 50 on your couch.
Yep.
Yeah.
See, that's why in nursing homes they say, this is for everyone over 62 or 55.
Yeah.
Because all those good for nothing.
Yeah, you can't come sit up there. Yeah.
You can't just sit up in
come
there.
Come on, come on, come on.
You can't have all the grandkids in your house.
Yeah.
When you're in a retirement facility.
Yeah. That's true.
Because they say no kids.
That's true.
Because their parents need to be raising their kids.
Yes.
Grandmother is a privilege.
Yep.
Grandparents.
Yeah. A privilege,
I'll
not a responsibility.
You back. And that's how ministry is.
That's right.
I'm going to teach you.
Yeah.
And then I'm going to push you out there.
Right.
I'm
that's
a
right.
Pusher.
That's right.
I push you into your destiny.
Yes.
That's what God has called me to do. To push
Amen.
You in your place.
Amen.
So
Amen.
That you can do your job. Amen. If I don't get you to do your job, then I'm not doing my job.
Well. Well, come on now.
We got to get this thing in order.
Mm-hmm.
Verse 8 says, therefore, do not be ashamed of the testimony of the Lord, nor of me, his prisoner, but share with me in the sufferings for the gospel according to the power of God, who has saved us and called us with a holy calling. Mm-hmm. Somebody say, holy calling.
Holy calling.
Holy calling. Holy calling. See, it doesn't say anything about apostle, pastor, a holy calling.
Holy calling.
Guess what? You've been called.
Amen.
Guess what? You've been called. Amen. You've been called. You've been called with a holy calling, not according to our works. See, everything that you've been doing, even what God had you doing at school, even the things that you like to do, all of that is in preparation for your purpose.
Yes, yes.
Even when you are at that job and you can't stand your boss and they're talking to you crazy, that's in preparation for your purpose.
Yes.
Even when you don't understand why they let you go, that's in preparation
for
your purpose.
Mm-hmm.
You don't understand why that just didn't work out. I don't know why we're not friends anymore, but that's in preparation for your purpose.
Yes.
So you've got to understand that you've been called, and God is saying, I just need you to say hello.
Hello. Hello.
I just need you to say hello, because God is calling you. Today, it's time for you to get on track for your great commission.
Right.
It's time for you
come
to
on,
get
on
track
good.
For your purpose.
That's good.
God
that's good.
To be right
that's
here,
good. That's
right
good.
Now,
yes, ma'am.
He has need
yes, ma'am.
Of you.
Yes, ma'am.
God
come
has
on.
Need
come on.
Of you. When he sent the disciples to get the colt that was unused, he sent the disciples to get the colt for Jesus. And what did they say? He has need of him.
Yep.
When he went to get Mary, she was untouched.
Uh-huh.
Why? God chose her. She was unused. And even if we've been used, God can still say, I have need of you.
Yes.
See, what happened was the enemy tried to misuse you. The enemy tried to make you spoiled.
Yeah.
The enemy tried to make you bad goods. But God said, all I need you to say is, hello?
Hello?
And get ready to do what God has called you to do. God has been calling you for years, but it just wasn't the right person and it wasn't the right time. It wasn't the right place.
Yep.
But God is saying, now is the time, and I need you to just say hello, because you've been called. And so here it says in verse 9, who has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which has been given to us in Christ Jesus before time began.
Come on now.
Yes.
But, girl, let her go.
Let her go.
Let her be free.
Yeah.
She is all right. Y'all can still hear me. But has now been revealed by the appearing of our Savior Jesus Christ, who has abolished death and brought life and immortality to light
gospel.
To which I was appointed a preacher,
yeah,
an apostle,
uh-huh,
and a teacher of the Gentiles. You see that, Pastor?
Mm-hmm.
You need to circle that, Pastor.
I've seen it. I've seen it before.
It says, yeah, in which you were appointed a preacher. Mm-hmm. Let me help you. An apostle.
Minister class.
Somebody say apostle.
Apostle.
Teacher.
Teacher.
Of who? The Gentiles, yeah, which means everybody. So you got to be able to accept your call.
Mm-hmm.
You got to be able to accept it and get ready for what God has for you to do.
Mm-hmm.
Verse 12 says, for this reason, I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed.
Mm-hmm.
No matter what I've been through, no matter how it looks, I'm believing God for more. Because what? I'm not ashamed. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed.
Yeah.
For I know who I have believed. I know who I have believed. I know who I am. I know who God's called me. I'm ready for my call.
Yes.
I'm ready to say hello.
Hello.
It says that he is, it says that, for I know who I believed and am persuaded. Today I am persuading you to say hello. Mm,
come on.
That he is able to keep what I have committed to him until the day that he comes back to get you. All you need to do is say hello. Mm. And once you say hello, God will start stirring up the gifts in you. God will start stirring up ideas. And it's like the things that you wanted to do a long time ago,
mm-hmm,
but you never could find the right place, the right time. God is saying, yeah, that. That's what I want you to do.
Yeah.
You got off track. You were worried about how am I going to pay my bills? How am I going to do this? You got off track.
Mm-hmm.
Somewhere in this, we got off track. We allow people to get into our purpose. We allow people to be a barricade,
mm-hmm,
to our promise. But between here and my promise,
mm-hmm,
I'm a bulldozer.
Mm. Come on now.
Like they were singing the other day, what they say? I'm a wrecking ball. What was that? Oh, it was good. Because he said, oh, I can't think of it. It was like, I'm something like a wrecking ball. And that's what we need to do. We need to wreck the enemy.
Yeah.
We need to knock him down. A wrecking ball is a big old huge ball on a chain.
Yeah.
And when they release it,
yeah,
it goes,
mm-hmm,
forward. And when it comes back, it demolishes everything forward and back.
Yeah.
So when whatever is in our way, forward, and then whatever was left that it didn't knock down on the way forward is going to knock the rest of it down on the way back, but it's not going to get you.
Come on now.
Amen?
Amen.
So we got to be willing and ready to walk in our commission.
Yes.
We got to be ready to do this thing for God. Hmm. Are you a disciple?
Yeah.
Have you been commissioned?
Uh-huh.
Are you ready to do it? Answer the call. You've been called. You were here because you've been called. And all you need to do is say, hello.
Mm-hmm.
Take one step and God is going to take the next step. If you have backslidden, see the very thing that they kept talking about over these last couple of days in the conference was about how men are coming back to the church.
Mm-hmm.
How people that used to be are coming back. The very thing that you said, I can't serve God because I did this or I did. The very thing that has been hindering you, God is saying, I want you back.
Mm-hmm.
What did I do to you?
Mm-hmm.
The church may have done that. The people in the church, because it's not the church.
Right.
It's the people in the church.
It's the people, yeah.
We're the people in progress. We can't get mad at the people that are still in progress, because we're still in progress.
Right.
So it's not the church that hurt you.
Mm-hmm.
It was the people in the church. And we have to get the thing that throws us off, the very thing why we get offended is because we're expecting the people in the church to be perfect.
Mm-hmm. Come on, man.
But we're not.
Come on.
So why are you letting an imperfect people stop you to get to your perfect purpose?
Mm-hmm.
Why? We accept all kind of foolishness outside the church and give them extra chances because we think that they don't know. But if people in the church, they don't know. They don't really realize what they're doing. That's why the Bible says, forgive them 7 times 70. So you can't count up how many times you gave them, forgave them before. You got to start all over again. You get to 50 and you're like, well, I think I'm at 50, 40 now. It's useless. Forgive them and get on to your purpose.
Amen.
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 You've been called. I need you to just say hello. Heavenly Father, we bless your people, Lord God. We bless this word, Father God. Father God, we ask you, Lord God, to cover this word in the blood of Jesus, Father God. Father God, we thank you for what you have sparked. We thank you for what you have pushed in us. We thank you, Father God, for the power and the glory.
Yes,
now, Lord
yes.
God, I pray in the name of Jesus, if there's anybody here under the sound of my voice that is in a backslidden state, that has not received you as the Lord and Savior, now is a good time to be saved because now is a great time for you to get on in. Get on in and get on the road to your purpose.
Yes, yes.
Now, Father God, in the name of Jesus, if there's anyone under the sound of my voice that wants to come back to you or that wants to get saved, it's a great time to come to the altar.
Amen, 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 amen.
It's a great time. God, again, just want you to say hello. God, again, just want you to say hello. God, again, just want you to say yes, Lord. Now, I'm not going to wait too long. Amen. Even if you're on Facebook, all you have to do is say hello.
Amen.
If you say hello, I'll lead you through the sinner's prayer. And amen.
Yes, yes.
Amen. Hello. And so the sinner's prayer is, Father God, in the name of Jesus, I am a sinner. And I want to be saved.
Yes, yes.
Jesus, I believe you died for my sins. Forgive me for everything I've done. Come into my heart. Change my soul and make me whole. Jesus, release your Holy Spirit in me and let him have his way. In Jesus' name. I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Now, Father
Amen.
God, I ask you now to, Lord God, continue.